afternoon. I'm not sure what I have to say, good morning or good afternoon, because the Spanish are always late. So I was not sure. So for me it's afternoon. Good afternoon. I was asked, I think 2 months ago, for this conference. And so we agreed, okay, downloadable design, that will be the title of my lecture. And when I prepared it last week, I changed it. And the title is now Open by Design. And in the conference information, it says that we built the online platform for downloadable design. I must say that it is still not there, and I'm not going to talk about it. If you have questions about it, I will answer them, but I want to change my talk a little bit. Open by design. It's the first time I do a lecture with Prezi, and the remote control is not reacting to it. Can you? So I have an assistant. I'm not coming from the world of hackers and makers. I'm not coming from the world of digital networks. I'm not coming from social design. I am an art historian, and I'm interested in beautiful objects. So what am I doing here? I'm one of those people who would immediately thought about what Alistair showed, the car made by 3,000 people. I thought, oh, what an ugly car. So that's me. But as an art historian and also how I am, I'm interested in change. I'm interested in technology. I'm interested in what the technology can do for design, how technology can change the world, how the society influences design, how design can influence society. So that's where I am coming from. In 1993, I set up, together with my partner, Prog Design, and I'm not going to talk about that, but I will show you a few products from the past, because I would like to show you that we always have been interested in the consumer, in the user, and that we always have been interested in bringing pleasure to the user, giving the user an experience. And that's exactly where I'm coming from. So here you see the doorbell. You can say it's an open design, because you see all the components. It's a different meaning of the word, of the expression open design. You can see all the components, and it's actually two glasses, and nobody knows that it's the doorbell. But when the hammer is going, when you press the button, and the hammer is going from left to right, then you hear ding-dong. And that's the moment all people have an experience, and they start laughing, and they have fun. And that's... Can you give me next? And here's the same story. Those people are sitting on a bench, and the bench is covered with marbles. And whoever is sitting on this bench, they have fun. And they are immediately making contact with the other people who are sitting on the bench. And this is the fence we created long time ago, and it's to share, it's about sharing, and it's to share your utensils, your garden utensils with your neighbor, or play ping pong with your neighbor. And all these designs have been made 10, 15 years ago. And this is our famous chest of drawers, and it was the first moment of a bit of open design. So you buy 20 old drawers, and the designer made a wooden case around it, and then you can build it up, you can build it like you want, and you can add things. And every piece will be different. So here a wine rack has been added, and there is also someone who added his television. People could bring in drawers, and but what happened? The Museum Boijmans of Beuningen, they bought this chest for the collection. And when they built it in their museum, they looked at the picture that they made when they bought it, and they two people from the staff were overseeing the building of the cupboard to see if it was exactly built like the picture, like it was on the picture. So for them, no open design. In 2000, we did Do Create with Kessels Kramer, and Do Create was to ask people to be creative, to challenge them to be creative, and to come. But it had nothing to do with the internet, with networking. It was just an idea of come out of your lazy chair and do something. So here's to scratch, and when you throw it through the room, it scratches instead of break. It doesn't break, it scratches, because there is a rubber lining inside the porcelain chair. And here we sold it as a wedding present. And actually, the plain vase is less interesting than the vase with the cracks. And this is the two hits. You buy a cube, a big cube, and then you have to hit it to slammer the hammer. And then, next piece, you have a chair. And actually, nobody bought the cube. Everybody bought the hammered piece. So, open design, but nobody did do it. Here the same story, the Douce Crest by Martí Cliché from Barcelona. It's a light box and it's painted black, and when you scratch in it, then the light comes out and it becomes a lamp. We didn't sell anyone. This is done in somewhere in Japan, I think, for an exhibition, but we asked an artist, and then the next one is finally we asked artists to scratch it because we couldn't sell it. That was in 2000. The Do Frame, I brought the tape, and the idea is that you frame your own pictures. And I wanted to frame something here, but I forgot the scissors, so I couldn't do it. So you frame your picture, like here. Can you have next? Or this product works quite well. It's quite easy. You have a roll of tape and you frame everything. So this is one of the users that did. Or this. So this was one of the first products which was really did work out. And then Rietveld, our famous Dutch architect. He published in the 30s the designs of his famous Red Blue chair, because it was his idea that people could make it themselves. That's what he did. And then in 2004, the designers Mario Minale, he created in his spirit. He thought, okay, I will use Lego blocks because everyone can create with Lego. And he created this Lego chair. And he wanted to have it open for the people to build it. And because of copyrights, he said, don't do that. Only produce a few of them as an art piece. Because we were stupid, we thought, okay, when it's an art piece, we can do it. And so we produced 5 of them and we sold them. And then a few months ago, we got the bill of the Heirs of Rietveld. Well, we do not show you the amount, but the amount is huge. So we went into discussion with them and we said, well, it's in the spirit of Rietveld. Why are you doing this? No, it's copying. And then I had to go to the lawyer. And the lawyer wrote a nice letter and said, well, it's not copying any blah blah. And then they wanted to bring us to court. And then we said, okay, pandemic have to go to court. We don't know what will happen. It costs us a lot of money. Let us pay. And I think this is ridiculous. And because of this project, not because of this project, but because of this whole discussion around copying, we started a year ago a project in China, and it's based on creative copying. So we went to China and we said to the Chinese, together with Chinese designers, let us copy the Chinese. And so we did. And we will present this project later this year. Next. This is 2003. Next, please. And it's a very early example of 3D printing. And it's the idea is that you print your own signature. It's a vase based on your own signature. In 2008, we did Urban Play. It was also about open design, but in the city. And this is a garden, an open garden, a movable garden by NL Architects. And the idea is that you can take the cars and put it all over the city in very dull places. You put a cart with a plant in it. And people did, really did. Here you see them working, yes, and here. And here, these are the civil servants bringing all the carts back to the original place because you are not allowed to place a cart in any place in the public space. It's too dangerous. Here, again by Marty Kishay. So this is a block of soft concrete, and people were allowed to sculpt. And from the very first moment we placed this in the city, people started sculpting. Next, please. And here you see a guy who made a very beautiful face. And then in the next slide, you see what happened. Someone else did do this. And here you see other people working on it. And for 6 weeks, people have been working on this block. And it became, it became more and more ugly. And the final result, something like this. And then, next slide, please. You see, there was no collaboration, no cohesion. There was competition because the guy with the beautiful face, it was slammed down immediately. There was vandalism, they were stealing the hammers, and the result was ugly. Next, please. And now I'm a bit cynical, sorry. And this was another one, the boom bench, and you could play your own, you could play your own music. Through Bluetooth, and it was a nice bench, it was well designed, but people had a great time because they just could play their own music through their mobile phone. So the bench was not open a design, only what the bench is offering you is open. And then design for download. Why did we do this? First, we would like people to customize products because we want to be open to people always. And we thought, okay, it would be nice if people can customize products and could give the people the experience of being creative. We were also interested in local production. So if you don't download the file, you can produce it in your neighborhood or even produce it yourself. And it also doesn't give overproduction, because if you only deliver the files, you don't have to create a big stock, a surplus of products. So there were several reasons why I wanted to do this. Next, please. And this, you saw it also in the lecture of Alistair. This was the show we did in Milan in 2010.
Yes.
And we focused on two techniques. One was 3D printing and the other was laser cutting. And this is the virtual forest, and it's based on 3D printing. And the idea was that you have, flowers are sent all over the world. They are transported from, they're growing in one country and they are sent over to other countries. And here you always have local flowers. That was the idea. And here you can do your sockets. You can design your own sockets and use it as a cover over the existing sockets. And you can see also the Lego technique has been used. So what we did, we created tools for customizing products. This is a very simple tool. You can change the dimensions and the amount of shelves. And then you choose the textile you want to use, and then you send this to us, and we send you the file, okay? And this could be the result, or this. And this is another one, and it's called, you see the boxes on top, and you can drag them to the place where you want, how big you want them, so you can change the whole piece. And the same, next please. And then you have built that, this. Or this. And you can see the work, what you have done with it is only the holes. And by making the holes, you change the shape and the dimensions. But the detailing remains the same. So whatever you are doing with it, the product will be the same. The design of the product. Yes? And this is a desk. And here again, you can do the same, yes. And this is, could be an outcome. Or this, it depends what you need. And we asked the designers who collaborated in this project to come up with business models. Because if you have people downloaded a file, how do you earn your money if you give the file for free or for €2? And we asked the designers to think about this problem. And here this designer, he said, okay, the file is for free, but here you see the clips, and the clips is a matter of 3D printing, and you have to buy the clips. So if you want the cupboard without the clips, you just have a simple cupboard, it's possible. But if you want really something special, you have to buy the clips. So that was his business model. And here are the clips. And here you see the cupboards, the shelves at the right. The designer said, okay, you have a mess in your house, you have computers, you have books, you have CDs or whatever. And you tell us what you have in your house, which products, and we make the cupboard for you. So personalized, but based on what people possess. but still personalized because this is what you need, but the designer is still the designer who is designing the cupboard. So that's maybe not completely open design, but half open design. So when we were thinking about the platform should call Make Me, and we were thinking about this, and we presented it last year, and we said, okay, everything is makeable, anytime, anywhere, by anyone. And that was our ideal picture. And we are still now in the stage of investigating how the business model will be, how we can continue with this customizing thing, because if people are joining in, maybe they need also software. Who is creating this software? Because the software we developed are only the tools which are necessary for the designer for those designs. If someone comes up with something totally different, maybe we have to develop new software. So there are a lot of questions still to be resolved. And the idea is everything is makeable anytime, anywhere, by anyone. Then, next, by anyone. And that's my problem. We have done some sort of open design in the past, and it turned out that nobody was really doing it. Maybe it was too complex, maybe too expensive, I don't know why. Maybe it was a different generation. But I would like to ask you, who in the audience is not a designer? And who of you would like to make and design all your products? Three. Four. Five. Yeah, but you are, it's your story. Four and a half. Okay, and I thought about 15. Put his finger on. Okay, fair enough. But I'm not so sure. I'm not so sure if people are willing to do it, if they are capable to do it, if they have time to do it. Of course there will be pioneers. Of course there have always been people who are doing it yourself, do it yourself always. And nothing has changed in this respect. But I think that still the majority of the people will not do it, and that's my problem. And I think the task of the designer is to create frameworks, for open design, and that's why I call it open by design, because if you create a framework which is very interesting, looks very good, then people can play around doing the most ugly things they want to do, because my problem is also that I'm afraid that it will get a flow of ugly things. You see, I'm a little bit cynical again. But it could be a new task for the designer to really concentrate on designing frameworks for people to be creative. And that's what I would like to say today. But I would like to add something inspired by the lecture of Alistair. Alistair was talking about teaching people to be creative, or teaching people skills. And well, that's very nice, and I think you have a lot of success with all the people you assembled to do this. But we did a project half a year ago in the poorest neighborhood of Rotterdam. And we wanted to do also to design a kind of framework in which these people could interact and play around or whatever. And this neighborhood, which is one of the poorest of the country, was so fed up with all those social projects. And they said, go away, you architects, you designers, we don't want you. And you are subsidized, and the money is not going to us, but to you, and go away with your projects. And last week, I finally met them personally, because I really wanted to know what was going on. And there were 10 very strong women coming from all places of the world, from Suriname, from Turkey, from Azerbaijan, whatever. And they said, we don't need you. We have all the skills, we have our talents, we can do it. We can sew our clothes, we can do this, we can cook, we can that. And then the problem became apparent, the municipality. The municipality was not open to them at all. They didn't care. And they only wanted the space to work there. And they didn't need nobody to teach them, they just wanted. So I would say open design is a very good thing, but we should also have an open government. Thank you.